السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Welcome to another episode of Gems of the Heart, where we try to learn means and ways to purify our hearts. These hearts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created for Himself, created the hearts to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And therefore these hearts would never attain happiness and tranquility and peace and goodness unless it's attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and earth. Unless these hearts, they fear only Allah, they hope for the rewards from Allah, unless these hearts are full of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than the love of anything on the face of earth, unless these hearts are pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be the Lord of the Alameen, to be pleased with the religion of Al-Islam, to be pleased with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, unless these hearts, they have that patience and the tranquility that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will establish in it as a result of the purification of these hearts. That's why the subject of the heart is a very serious one. It's an important one. Matters of belief in the heart, deeds done by the heart, and that's the foundation for any goodness in one's speech and actions. Many people, they out of, you know, for many reasons, they might take care of their outside appearance, they might take care of their speech and actions physically, but they're not paying attention to what's in their hearts. And as a matter of fact, and the reason why I'm saying as a matter of fact, because many people, they don't consider that as a matter of fact. So as a matter of fact, we do not know ourselves the way we ought to, unless we refer to the Qur'an and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And that's a very shocking thing to many people. We do not know ourselves. Yes, we do not know ourselves. We do not know ourselves unless we get to know ourselves from the Qur'an and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And that's why we would oftentimes see others, and we are falling into the same thing if we're not paying attention. You would find a liar saying, "I'm truthful." You would find a person that is not upon generosity and goodness, and he considers himself as generous and good, and so on. So we do not know ourselves. We do not know what's in our hearts even. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. That's why we have to constantly learn and constantly purify our hearts. And as mentioned before, when it comes to the physical actions or to the physical body, whenever a person is afflicted by a disease or harm, or even before that happens, we take certain measures to protect ourselves from harm. You don't take a medicine before the disease comes. A person has to have the sickness and then he takes the medicine for it. If a person is healthy and he takes medicine for a specific disease, this can be very fatal or harmful for him. But when it comes to the hearts, the matter is different. Taking the remedies and taking the medicine for all kinds of diseases in the heart is a good thing. Not the physical diseases, but the disease of shirk. If a person wants to cure himself from associating partners with Allah or the roots of that which has been attached to other than Allah, take the remedy for it, which is establish the tawheed of Allah. Worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone in what all that means, and learning how to be upon the tawheed, the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes and so on. If a person wants to be not arrogant and not to have any kibr or arrogant in one's heart, don't start by praising oneself, by saying, "I'm not arrogant, I'm a humble person." Don't say that. Take the remedy for arrogance, and that is do the opposite of it. Be humble, read and learn and listen from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. What is arrogance? What is the definition of al-kibr? And how to protect ourselves from it, and how to cure ourselves from it. And by doing these actions, by taking this medicine, that means the heart will be purified. Because if we leave ourselves like this, The heart can be full of all kinds of diseases when we're not aware of it. So that's why it's a constant battle with the shaitan. It's a constant purification. Like our houses, our bodies, if you leave it without cleaning it, it becomes dusty, it becomes dirty, even though you didn't bring the dirt in. It just happens. And that's the same thing with the hearts. And that's why we constantly have to purify ourselves. And we've been talking about the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as one of the very important means to purify our hearts. To know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes, the way it was described in the Quran or in the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, to have the reality of it, to believe in it in the right way. And to make this part of our life, it's one of the very effective means, if it's not the most effective, you know, to purify the heart from all kinds of illnesses and diseases, and to purify our hearts with the best thing ever, to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes. We talked about many of them, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the help and the guidance to know more and more, and to be upon the truth and to be steadfast upon it till the moment of death. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we'll go through one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam ordered us in the authentic hadith to frequently make dua using it. So there's a dua that the Prophet said, Alidhu biyadha al-jalali wal-Ikraam, which means, Alidhu means be on it, right? That means constantly, all the time, say yadha al-jalali wal-Ikraam. And that's what we will talk about inshallah ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Thul-Jalali wal-Ikraam. This is one of the names of Allah. This is, has attributes with it. And that's something that we're supposed to constantly use it in our dua. The dua is the ibadah. And it's an essential thing for our life that we cannot live without the dua. We constantly have to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَتَكُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ مَا سَأَلْتُمُوا. He gave you from whatever you ask for. And in the tafsir of this verse, it also means that He gave you the things that you didn't even ask Him for. People, they breathe the air and they don't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it, even though they ought to ask. This air that we breathe, the ability for us to breathe, is it something that we earn it? Do we deserve it because we're, you know, such great individuals? And no, it's something that is given to us, right? Isn't it a great favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Imagine someone is not able to breathe. You know, for a few seconds he will see the importance and the value of this great favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then a person then, would he then ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have the ability to breathe? Right? We should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala constantly if we really have the reality of things. Therefore, we would be constantly asking Allah for inhaling and exhaling. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us things that we don't even ask for. And therefore, we have to constantly ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have opportunity to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala every day. You know, in the fard salah only, we have the opportunity to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the position of the sujood only, even though the dua is not just in the position of sujood or prostrating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but in the sujood only, in the prostrating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the salah. In the fard salah only, 34 times. 34 times the person, the Muslim, is in the closest position to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ مِنْ رَبِّهُ وَسَاجِدُ. The closest, the nearest position that a person is in to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is when he is sajid, when he is making sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَأَكْثِرُ فِيهِ مِنَ الدُّعَاءِ. So make a lot of dua then. فَإِنَّهُ قَامِنٌ أَنْ يُسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ. That means it's more likely for the dua to be accepted in that position, because that's the nearest position that a person can be into Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the question comes in, we talked about that before. It's important to be reminded all the times. Is there anyone on the face of earth make sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala other than the ummah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? And that's an amazing thing. And that's by the mercy of Allah. Even though in the books, you would find it in the Bible and the books before, that their prophets, the prophets of Allah, they used to make sujood. Isa alayhi salam and so on. But what happened to the people? That by itself is a great sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that if anybody truly want to follow the ways of the prophets of Allah, Nuh and Ibrahim and Musa and Isa and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, embrace the deen of Islam. follow the way of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. You will be near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at least, that's if a person doesn't pray the optional salah, the sunan salah, at least 34. You add to it 12 rak'ah, sunnah, ratiba, and each rak'ah, we do have two sujood in it. That means 24 that you added to the 34. So then now you got 58 times that you make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can add to it the witr salah, the night prayer. You know, the matter keeps on going and going. And how many, this is, if you do something once a day, that's a lot of things. That's a lot of things that you can achieve if you do it once a day. So imagine that we're, as Muslims, we are supposed to do this dua every day. This is not even mentioning when a person sits and make dua. Between the adhan and the iqamah, the dua is never rejected, as the Prophet ﷺ said. Between the adhan and the iqamah, at the end of the tashahud, every time a person sits and makes tashahud, you know, the last part of the night, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends in a way that fits His Majesty subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it rains, all kinds of times, when a person feels like making dua, the salatul istikhara, constantly the believers are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here, a great favor from Allah, that if a person is sincere and having the certainty, and there are many etiquettes to be taught and for us to learn how to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, something that we would do 34, 54 times a day, we need to know the knowledge of it, how to do it, the etiquettes of doing it, how to have our dua accepted, how to make sure that our dua is not rejected, because there are things that would make the dua rejected and not accepted because of our own evil actions. So one of the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that the Prophet ﷺ taught us how to make dua. One of which is to raise, when we raise our hand, and this is not the subject, right? We're talking about Thul-Jalali wal-Ikraam, or Thul-Jalali wal-Ikraam. But just one something, just one etiquette, just to get us an idea to learn more and more how to make dua, just the fact that we raise our hands like this to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said in the authentic hadith that inna Allah hayy, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most shy, that yastahi min abdihi, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is shy from his slave, and he's the most rich subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he would extend his hand to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would reject his dua, and he would make his hand sifra, that means he would not get in anything as a result of his dua. So the fact that a person is begging and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most high, he's shy from his slave that he would not give him anything when he asks. So how can a person then sit back and relax and don't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Really, if we know the reality of it, we will constantly ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't even have to sit and raise your hand and make dua. You can be sitting with your friends, with your parents, with your family, and you say, Allahumma ghfirli. This is how they used to count for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 100 times, that he would say this in the same majlis. Allahumma ghfirli wa tub alay. That, oh Allah, forgive me, make me repent to you, oh Allah. You know, a person walking in the street can make a da'wah, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and of course in the salah and things like this. But, and again, going back to the subject of this, is the Prophet ﷺ gave us a great gift for the dua to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he used the word alivu, which means frequently, constantly. Use this name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your dua. And who's the one that is saying that to us? The Prophet ﷺ. The best man ever worshipped Allah. The best man ever made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one that his dua was accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He did not leave this ummah unless he informed it about everything that would get it closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing would get us away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unless the Prophet ﷺ had ordered us and advised us. He had the nasiha and the concern to his ummah. And one of which, something simple like this. So, alidhu biya dhal jalali wal ikram, constantly in your dua, say, Ya dhal jalali wal ikram. Very easy and simple. And then ask, Ya dhal jalali wal ikram. Ya, oh. Dhal jalali wal ikram, because it's after ya, right? Ya dhal jalali wal ikram. Tha, or originally, dhu, means the owner of. The owner of al jalal wal ikram. Al jalal is majesty, is power and majesty, that when someone, from the human perspective, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing is the like of him. When someone has jalal, that means you might not be able to look at the face of that person because of the great you know, jalal that Allah put in his face, whether it's because of his honor, because of his dignity, something that people would understand what is meant by this when they deal with people that are well respected, someone that is very righteous, the people of knowledge, for example. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him this. Amr ibn al-As, you know, radiallahu anhuma, when he was dying, he said something in the meaning of which, in which when after he became a Muslim, he said because of the great love that he had to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that he was not able even to look into the eyes of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam because of how much respect and how much love that he had to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And he said to the people, he said to his son, that if you even ask me to describe to you how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam looked like, I would not be able to. Why? Because he did not get his eyes full of looking at the face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam because of this love to the Prophet ﷺ, because of the beauty of the Prophet ﷺ that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon him, physical beauty and the beauty of his soul and being the best man. Imagine that you're looking at the best man ever created. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made this in the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to follow the way of the best man ever created, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And that's why being grateful to Allah, having this great feeling that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed such a favor upon us to be followers of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So ya dhal jalal, al-jalal again is the majesty, is the honor that comes with mighty you know, attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the almighty, al-aziz subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that is able to do all things, the one that is nothing is the like of him, the creator of the heavens and the earth, that are mighty creation of Allah. Can anybody and nobody would be able to imagine in this life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth. So Allah, he subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of al-jalal, the majesty and the power and the honor and so on. Wal-Ikraam, al-Ikraam is honor and dignity. The owner of al-jalal, majesty and honor. And this is something that brings the humbleness, since it's in the subject of the dua. When a person is asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's asking the one, the owner of majesty, the one that is the owner of all things. You know, when someone wants to ask from someone in this life something, who do you ask? You ask from someone that has the ability to fulfill your request, right? If a person wants a dime, wants a dollar, wants something very small, and he asks a human being that is very generous, say one's father, a son asking his father, and the father is, you know, multi-billionaire, right? And he's asking him for just $1 because he's in need desperately. He is in need of it desperately for this $1, right? Would that generous father that has billions and billions and billions, would he be greedy to give him this one penny or $1? Of course not. This is a concept where some of the early generations of Islam, they mentioned the example of this in the day of Arafah, when, you know, thousands and of the people that are gathered in the same place, the day where the shaitan is never seen more humiliated than he is seen in the day of Arafah. And they're all asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're all making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the day of Arafah, the ninth of the Hijjah in Hajj. And one of the early generations of Islam, he said in the meanings of which, that he said, if all of these people, they're asking a rich man in this life to give them a danaq. Danaq is something like a, you know, a money that is worth nothing. Is basically like a penny or something that is worth not much. Would that rich, generous man reject them when they're all begging and asking and asking? Of course, the answer, of course, is not. They're not asking for his wealth. They're asking for something that has no value to it whatsoever. Definitely, he would give them. So that then he said, how about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most generous subhanahu wa ta'ala? Would you think that he would reject their dua and asking and seeking his help and forgiveness and bestowing upon them his favor subhanahu wa ta'ala? That's bad expectations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if a person think that they will be rejected. And he subhanahu wa ta'ala is Thul-Jalali wal-Ikraam, the owner of al-Jalal, majesty. He's able to do all things. And you add to it all the names and attributes of Allah. He's the most generous, he's the most forgiver, he's the most merciful, and so on. So the owner of al-jalal wal-ikram, al-ikram honor. And al-ikram also can come into the meaning of generosity. He gives, subhanahu wa ta'ala, without any account, without returning back, without having, you know, the matter to be returned like human beings do. And he's the most rich, he does not expect anything from the human being. He's the one that created them. And they all shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is in no need of them. So that's why asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this name, Ya Thul-Jalali wal-Ikraam, if we have the reality of it in our hearts and the proper belief in it, that brings the acceptance of the dua. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, he did not just say Ya Thul-Jalali wal-Ikraam whenever you would want to make dua once in a while. He said Alivu. That means stay upon it constantly. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for using this name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Thul-Jalali wal-Ikraam, the owner of Al-Jalal wal-Ikraam. And also when it comes to how this name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned in the Quran, we would see that it's mentioned in Surah Ar-Rahman. Surah Ar-Rahman. And Ar-Rahman is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most beneficent, most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the relationship of that being mentioned in it twice, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran, in Surah Ar-Rahman, twice. And this is something when we go to the surah and read the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in in Surah Ar-Rahman, كل من عليها فان ويبقى وجه ربك ذو الجلال والإكرام. كل من عليها فان, that means every single creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the earth, fan, that means will vanish. Maybe the word vanish comes from it, Allahu A'lam. Fan, that means, you know, everything will vanish, everything will die, everything will go away. Anything on the face of it, any life will go away. And then وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ, which means, and يَبْقَى then stays, وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ, the face of your Lord, ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ, the owner of Al-Jalal, majesty, and Ikram, which is honor and generosity and goodness and so on. And also at the end of the surah, the last verse in Surah Ar-Rahman, after mentioning all of these favors of Allah and after mentioning what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared for the disbelievers in the hellfire and the Jannah with its two levels for the believers, and these great favors from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the believers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the end of the surah, he said, تبارك اسم ربك ذي الجلال والإكرام. That tabarak, that means he is the one to be praised, the perfect praise, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his name deserve the perfect praise, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dhil jalali wal ikram, the owner of al jalal, the honor, wal ikram, and honor and dignity and generosity and all kinds of things like this. So this is something that is mentioned in the Quran, mentioned in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. One of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that should affect our lives, and we should use it constantly, and that's what's the benefit, one of the benefits of it. But we'll continue inshallah ta'ala with more after the break, so stay with us inshallah. Change your heart, Lord, change our heart.
I don't think it's such a big deal to say a white lie from time to time, or to make joke of somebody just having a bit of fun. Can it be such a major deal?
Well, the Prophet ﷺ told us that an individual may say a word without paying any attention to it that would take him down in hell pits more than the distance of a 70 years for a traveler.
I don't want to go to the hellfire. How can I save myself?
To save yourself, you have to work hard for it. The Prophet ﷺ guaranteed paradise for those who do not want to go to hell.
Sheikh, can you tell me about the details of what exactly must I do and what should I preserve in order to go to paradise?
It sounds a little bit easy, but it isn't. The Prophet said ﷺ, whoever guarantees what's between his jaws and what's between his thighs, meaning that he observes and preserves them, the tongue and the private parts, I guarantee him Jannah.
So my dear brothers and my dear sisters, we have a beautiful series called Mind Your Tongue. Join us with our well-respected Sheikh Asim Al-Hakim. He's going to be at the receiving end of our questions, and inshallah ta'ala, he's going to do a fantastic job of explaining all the different concepts and how we can purify ourselves and be the best Muslims that we can.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulullah. Welcome back, and we're talking about the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Thul-Jalali wal-Ikraam, the owner of Al-Jalal, the majesty, the azama, the exaltation. He's the most exalted subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the one that is able to do all things, and he's the most honored wal-Ikraam, the most honored subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most generous subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we heard that how in our dua, we should frequently use Ya Dhal Jalali Wal Ikram. So use it like when you ask Ya Dhal Jalali Wal Ikram, and then you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Using these names and attributes from Allah, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is one of the means to achieve the acceptance of the dua and to have the good thinking and expectations from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, as a benefit of having that belief, because it, you know, the effect of it is in our life and our actions and being obedient to Allah and humbling ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, there's a great benefit that we get to learn how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whenever he would give salam in his fard salah, as we know, he would say, Astaghfirullah, 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 and Takbir, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And right after that, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say, Allahumma anta as-salam, wa minka as-salam, tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram. And many of us, we know this dhikr. So we use the name of Dhul Jalali wal Ikram in our dua after the salah. Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram, as the last verse of Surah Ar-Rahman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as-salam, one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one that brings peace and safety from all harm and so on. Wa minka salam, and from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as-salam and goodness and safety and security and so on. Tabarakta, that means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most exalted, the most perfect in his names and attributes. Ya dhal jalali wal ikram, O the one, the owner of majesty and azama and exaltation, and al ikram. How many times we do that every day? Five times a day we say that after finishing the salah. And of course the shaitan try to take the people away from making dhikr and remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after the salah. So we have to make sure that we say these types of adhkar. To apply also that one of the effect of believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he is the owner of Al-Jalali wal-Ikram, is to be kind to others, is to respect others. It has that sense of respect, as we said. So when we talk about the worship of Allah, it's full of respect, if it's correct to say. It's full of good manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a person humble himself to the Most High, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and performing the duties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do, when the time for the salah comes, a person, you know, immediately gets ready to make the salah and so on. So one of which is it has an effect also in the manners of the Muslim. If we believe in Ya Dhal Jalali wal Ikram, or the owner of Al Jalali wal Ikram, has its effect in the life of a Muslim and his manners with others, especially for those who deserve from the person to respect them and to give them their rights. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said that in the authentic hadith, إن من إجلال الله, from the إجلال of Allah, from you exalting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being the one that has the majesty and the power and the honor, part of that is to do what? إكرام ذي الشيبة المسلم. To have إكرام, to have generosity and goodness and honor, to honor the shaybati Muslim, the Muslim that has gray hair. The Muslim, your elders, those who have gray hair, that means they are old in age. Right? To honor them, to respect them. That's part of believing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Thul-Jalali wal-Ikraam. It's part of you making ijlal of Allah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows His mercy upon these individuals. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Prophet also said, that when a person, his hair turns gray while he's been a Muslim, right? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is shy from that person. That person gets reward for every hair that it becomes gray, that becomes a hasana, as long as he's been a Muslim. So to honor such a person, because Allah honors them, that's part of honoring Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, respecting the orders of Allah. It's an amazing thing, and it shows how the manners and dealing with others is part of our deen. So that's one category of people, ikram bi shaybati muslim, and also the ikram to hamil al-Qur'an, to the one that has the Qur'an, the one that carries the Qur'an in his heart, someone that memorized the Qur'an. غير الغالي في والجافي عنه. Not the one that is extreme with regards to the Qur'an, or the one that is jafi, that means he is away from applying the Qur'an. Because a person might have the Qur'an memorized, but he's upon extremism, not the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, like the Khawarij did. They know the Quran by heart and so on, but the Quran did not go beyond their vocal cords. And the Prophet wasalam mentioned about them because they fell into this trap of extremism and evenness. So not the one like this, and not the one that is jafi'an, the one that is turning away from the Quran. He had it memorized, but he does not apply it in his life. He follows his desire. So this might happen, it's valid to happen. So this is not what is meant by this. Hamil Qur'an, the one that carries the Qur'an, the one that has the Qur'an inside of him, that he applies the Qur'an, that he is upon the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, following the way of the Prophet sallam. If you believe in Allah that he is Dhul Jalali wal Ikram, to honor Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to be kind and generous and respectful to the one that has the Qur'an memorized, and he's not one of these two extremes. And also, as the Prophet ﷺ said, the third category of people, and to make that also that ikram as a result of that, to this Sultan al-Muqsit, to the ruler that he has authority and he's just. If he's just, to respect him and to honor him and so on. So these are evidence or implementation that shows that how the person, when he's exalting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that would affect him in his livelihood matters and dealing with people. And that's why in our hearts, if we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we would respect those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. At least from their outside appearance, we do not know what's in the hearts. We love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We love the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with them and they're pleased with him. We love the people of the early generations of Islam that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam praised. The people of knowledge, the imma of this deen, we love them. The four imams, al-Bukhari rahimahullah, Muslim, those who preserved Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, made them the means to compile the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, not to attack them like these evil people, that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them or make them turned away with their evil, away from the ummah of the Muslims, to respect and to love these imma of this deen, and to love the ulama, the people of knowledge, those who have the knowledge of the deen of Islam and they apply it in their life, to respect them, to honor them, as the Prophet ﷺ mentioned with regards to Hamil al-Qur'an, to the one that carries the Qur'an, to show that respect in our communities for those who are elders, to take care of them, to be after their needs. And if there is any society that they care for those who are elders, we should not wait for governments to take care of that. We as individuals, we should have that in ourselves, and not to neglect them and to put them in nursery homes and the like of this, to abandon them because we're busy. You know, a son and a daughter not taking care, especially the son not taking care of their fathers and their mothers when they're old, when they are the most people that had favor upon them. When the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he mentioned in the hadith, when someone asked him, an ahsan nasi bi husni sahabati, who is the one that who has the rights on me to be the best companion, he said, your mother three times, and then your father. And the word sahabati, that means he's my companion. A person should be the companion of his parents, not to leave them. When it comes to provision, sometimes people, they leave their parents. But if they know the virtue and the goodness of being with their parents and to take care of their parents, even if they're not physically in need of them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide for you. And Allah subhanahu, because this is part of the ijlal of Allah. It's part of believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He is Thul-Jalali wal-Ikraam, is to respect those who are elders, especially those who are related to us. A child that was born and raised by his parents and so on, now they're old in age. They have the gray hair, their age and so on. Then to take care of them, to be there for them. This is one of the basics that you would find or used to find when you go to the East and the West in any Muslim community. This bond and social bond between the families and the relatives and so on. It becomes weaker and weaker the more that, you know, people start imitating the ways of others and they become more materialistic. And we need to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to bring back these values and to have respect and honor of people and the neighbors and the elders, as the Prophet ﷺ said, and how that is related to the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Dhul Jalali wal Ikram, that He subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one, the bestower of the majesty, He's the one that has the majesty and He's the one that has al Ikram and honor and generosity and the like of this. Also, one of the things that we need to be upon, and this is actually, these are all many different subjects that we need to expand upon, and we need to be upon these types of meaning, seeking rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to see what's in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and respect that. Right? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do anything, right, even to smile to a Muslim, have that respect that the fact of the matter is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us. Exalt that order to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that it becomes an important thing in your life. Don't belittle it, right? And sometimes a person, and that shows the effect of the heart, might belittle something or exalt something or respect something. And that's a deed that a person is either rewarded for or sometimes punished for it. How is that? I will give you an example. When you have, for example, sins, right? Major sins and minor sins. Major sins are, to much extent it's known, and minor sins. The main difference is that major sins, you know, the sins that has a specific punishment attached to it. And minor sins, other sins. But in the heart, if a person committed a minor sin, right? But in the heart is belittling that sin, thinking that it's a small sin. What's the big deal of committing that small sin, right? That fact that a person is belittling the sin, this attitude is a major sin. Not that the minor sin becomes major, but this attitude of the heart is a major sin. Which shows that how this issue of al-ijlal and not, to exalt or not, to belittle something, to respect something, to honor something or not to honor something, it's a very serious matter in our life. People, for example, honoring soccer players. Some people, they honor movie stars. Some people honor whatever, right? Whatever they are attached to, they honor. For a Muslim, we honor who? We honor those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored in the Quran and the Sunnah. And it doesn't have to be that we are, you know, doing evil to others, but we're talking about honoring, respecting, you know, showing this respect and honor. Of course, the respect should be for everybody, but to long for such attitude and such characteristics as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned certain individuals with their characteristics in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What if they are poor or rich? Does it make a difference? Some people, they only respect those who are rich. If someone is poor, they look down at that person. They belittle that person. Even if that person is someone as from these categories that we talked about in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. An elder Muslim, but he's poor. Or he's not someone that people look up to or respect. We as Muslims, we should respect that person and we should give him respect and honor him, right? And not to belittle such a person, not to humiliate such a person or to show that we are giving them charities and helping them and the like of this. And the more the person is closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more that we need to respect. But again, this also the concept, the perception. Who are the ones that we look up to? Who are our examples and role models in this life? Is it the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? When we were asked, who is your example and role model in this life? For a Muslim, is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنٌ. Indeed, you have in the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasalam the best example. لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرَ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. For those who seek the hereafter and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the way to have this, because this is, you know, something that, how can we achieve this level of respecting those who deserve to be respected and looking at things in the way that it should be, we need to be attached to the Book of Allah. Read the Quran. See who's respected in the Quran and who is mentioned in the opposite way. And that's how the hearts of the believers, they respect and they honor what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored. They stay away from those who are not honored, for example, in the Quran, according to the hereafter. That's why the hearts has to be attached to the hereafter. Who are the ones that will be honored in the Day of Judgment? This is where the hearts, they have that respect and they show that respect. And those who are mentioned in the Quran that they will be humiliated in the hereafter. Someone showed these characteristics. Allah knows best who's going to die in what state. But to stay away from imitating them. Part of why people, they imitate one another, because they look up to them. They respect them. They, think that they are such a great people and so on. But for the believers, they should imitate the Prophet ﷺ, the people of knowledge, the people of righteousness. But again, turning away from the deen, weakening our iman with sins and forgetfulness, makes the heart attached to what is falsehood and those who are upon falsehood, and to respect those who do not deserve to be respected, and to honor those who do not deserve to be honored, and vice versa. Life becomes very confusing. And that's why this is all part of believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He is Thul-Jalali wal-Ikraam. He is the one, the owner of Al-Jalal, the honor and the majesty, and subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most generous subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another thing is that we need to pay attention to when we talk about these names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that we need, as we mentioned earlier, that we need to make dua to Allah. And when you're making dua, there's that state of humbleness in the hearts, because you're asking, when someone is begging, from another human being, what does that human being do? He shows all kinds of need, right? And that's why the miskeen, the one that poverty made him in that state of sukoon, not moving too much, not arrogant, he's in need. That's why they would say all kinds of things and begging and asking, and this is not a very pleasant thing, of course. For the believers, when they make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are more in need than anyone else, because they know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of all things. So to bring this in the hearts, when you say, Ya dhal jalali wal ikram, right, don't think of yourself that you are all that, or that you have this or that, or you're smart, or you have a great job, or you have a paycheck that comes at the end of the month, or you're able to do things, or you're very good at making decisions. Forget about all of these things. When a person is making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he thinks of nothing but the power of Allah. And he sees oneself as no power, no might, nothing. And this is the reality of it if we think about it, right? Very clear to understand. But this is part of what a person would say when he says, Ya dhal jalali wal ikram, that we humble ourselves. And this is the essence of the ubudiyya, or servitude, or to be slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to witness that state of oneself. That takes the arrogance away. That's why we need to say it frequently. It takes the arrogance away from the heart. And the arrogance is the one of the main reasons why the dua is not accepted, why a person would enter the hellfire, all kinds of evil things as a result of arrogance in the heart. So to remove this is to constantly say, Ya dhal jalali wal ikram. So as you see, matters of belief, knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes, learning matters of the religion of Islam, to know who to respect and who to not, and things of that nature, how to deal with people. And that's part of our deen. There are verses in the Quran, hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that gives us the guidelines of how to deal with human beings on the face of earth. There are many different things in our life. There is ourselves, there's our parents, our children, our brothers and sisters, the enemies, the friends, the neighbors, all kinds of things that happens in our life. Is there way and guidelines of how to deal with people on the face of earth? Definitely. And that needs knowledge, and for a person to humble himself to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to learn the deen of Islam and to follow the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Another thing also that we need to really reflect upon when we talk about the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of which is Dhul Jalali wal Ikram, is to be generous and to be kind to others. And to be generous with one's wealth, with one's time, with one's ability and health, to be kind to others, knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of al-Jalali wal-Ikraam. And He is the one to be honored, and that's why we need to honor ourselves by being generous to others and being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and knowing that Allah bestowed these favors upon us, and therefore we would do these types of goodness to others as a result of that, as the way of al-Ijlal, or exalting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes. And that has a great effect in our life, in our livelihood matters, in our provisions, in our obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that makes the heart away from what prevents people from entering the hellfire. You know, people, they enter the hellfire, preventing, you know, ourselves from taking the means that makes a person fall into the hellfire, wal-a'yadhu billah, when a person does not have this goodness and generosity in the heart, which is part of believing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of majesty, and He's the owner of generosity and goodness and kindness and honor, right? And the more the person is busy with something, the more that his heart will be affected by it. So sometimes we're overpowered to honor or to not to honor things according to what we are indulged in many times of our life. For example, if we want to protect our hearts from honoring those who do not deserve our honor, basically, those who spread corruption on the face of earth, don't constantly watch them. Don't constantly hear what they say, because the hearts can be affected. But rather, right, we have enough for us that we spend our time to learn what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, to learn what's in the Quran and what's in the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. That's what we need to be busy with ourselves, listening to the Quran, reading Quran. We will get the understanding and the proper honor in our life. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who listen and follow the orders of Allah, and to give us the right perspectives of things. Wa sallallahu sallam wa barak ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Mindful of what you say, be sincere when you pray. Today could be your last day. Bear each other no malice. Greed and faith can coexist in the same heart.